everyone, welcome back to our channel. This is Dr. Nazma Sheikh, and in this video we are going to continue the NCERT solutions of the chapter Some Basic Concepts of Chemistry. In NCERT solutions part 1 we have covered the first 5 questions, and today we are going to start from question number 1.6. Let's read the question. Calculate the concentration of nitric acid in moles per liter, which is nothing but molarity, in a sample which has a density of 1.41 grams per ml and the mass percent of nitric acid in it is 69%. So you know mass percentage, you also know the density, and you got to calculate molarity. We already know the formula of molarity is N by V, which is nothing but number of moles of solute by the volume of the solution. And the units of this is going to be moles per liter. So now, how do we acquire number of moles from the given, and how do we acquire the volume from the given so that we can substitute the values in this formula of molarity and calculate what has been asked in the question. So let us go one by one. So here in the first case, you have mass percentage of nitric acid given. It says that it is 69% by mass, right? So which in turn means if you're talking about a solution of 100 grams of nitric acid solution, in that 69 grams is nitric acid, HNO3, and rest is water. So now you're having 69 grams of HNO3 by mass. If it is 1 mole of HNO3, it would be 63 grams, but you're having 69 grams right now. So how many moles is it? Cross multiply, it is 69 into 1 divided by 63, which on simplification gives you 1.095. So this is the number of moles of HNO3 that you have, and from where did you calculate it? You have calculated from the mass percent of nitric acid. So now we know the number of moles. Next, we need to know the volume of nitric acid solution so that we can substitute it in the formula of molarity and calculate the required. So volume can be calculated from density. So in the question, it's been said that the density is 1.41 grams per 1 ml, right? So if density is equal to mass by volume, you want to calculate volume, you can find it out from mass by density. So you know the mass, you know the density. Substitute both of them. It's given in the question itself that it is 100 grams. From here, you can identify 69 mass percentage, as in the total mass of the solution is 100 grams. I'm taking the same here. And divided by density, which is 1.41. Substituting and simplifying this, we get the actual value, which is 70.92 into 10 power minus 3 liters. Always remember, in the formula of molarity, which is N by V, volume is taken in terms of liters. So though out of your calculation you will be getting it in ml, you have to convert it into liters. 70.92 into 10 power minus 3 liters is the volume. So we know the number of moles, we know the volume. Just got to substitute it in the formula of molarity to calculate the concentration. Once you substitute and simplify, the final answer is 15.44 moles per liter. I hope you are understanding how to solve it. In case of any doubts, as usual, please let me know your doubts in the comment section. Let's quickly move on to the next question, number 1.7. How much copper can be obtained from 100 grams of copper sulfate? So they're talking about copper sulfate. So if you're taking 100 grams of copper sulfate, from 100 grams of copper sulfate, what will be the mass of copper element that can be obtained is what is asked. So for this to be understood, first of all, let us calculate the molecular mass of copper sulfate. Copper sulfate is also called as blue vitriol. It's important that you know the common name of a few important chemicals. And the common names are also there in the syllabus. They might be asked in the examination, in final examination. So know the common names as you learn the topics. So copper sulfate, CuSO4, 1 mole will be equal to the mass of 1 copper, which is 63.5, plus mass of 1 sulfur or 1 mole of sulfur atoms, which is 32, plus the mass of 4 moles of oxygen atoms, which is 64, 4 into 16, so which is altogether 64. So the mass, the molar mass of copper sulfate is 159.5 grams when you sum it. We know that 1 mole of copper sulfate is how much? 159.5 grams. Cool. And now in this 1 mole of copper sulfate, how many moles of copper do you have? You have 1 mole of copper atoms, right? So 1 mole of copper atoms is how much? It is 63.5. So if you are having 159.5 grams of copper sulfate with you, out of this whole 159.5 grams of mass, 63.5 grams is the mass of copper. And now in the question, what did they ask us? They are asking about 100 grams of copper sulfate. So now I don't have 159.5 grams. I just have 100 grams of copper sulfate. And now you got to calculate the mass of copper in this 100 grams. So cross multiply, it will be 100 into 63.5 divided by how much? 159.5. So here you go. You got to simplify this. Once you simplify, you'll be getting 39.81 grams. This is the mass of copper present in 100 grams of copper sulfate solution. Copper sulfate solid. If you take 100 grams of copper sulfate and decompose it, you will be getting 39.81 grams of copper. So this is about question number 1.7. Let's move to 1.8. Determine the molecular formula of an oxide of iron in which the mass percent of iron and oxygen are 69.9 and 30.1 respectively, given that the molar mass of oxide is 159.69. So now the point is, if you have watched my part 1 video, in part 1, I guess question number 1.3 or 1.4, I'm not sure about the number, but one of those questions was about the very same concept. They were asking empirical formula back then. Now they are asking molecular formula. Even then they gave the same mass percentages. They said that iron's mass percentage is 69.9 and oxygen's is 30.1. And then we have calculated the empirical formula. We stopped it over there. But then here we have to continue the same to calculate the molecular formula. So before we could go to solve this, let me tell you a few tricks about calculating or identifying molecular formula. So one thing that you need to remember is empirical formula is the short form of molecular formula. And when you take empirical formula and molecular formula relation, molecular formula is empirical formula into N. And now what is this N? N is nothing but the ratio of molecular formula mass divided by empirical formula mass. If you take the molecular formula mass and empirical formula mass, and if you divide them by each other, the value that you get is N. And if you take this N, you multiply this N with the empirical formula that you have, you will be getting the molecular formula. Please make a note of these two formulae. These two are very important when it comes to the concept of empirical and molecular formula. Fine. So now let's go on to see how to calculate it. Also, let me remind you that in order to find out the empirical formula, I told you three steps back then. Of it, step one is identifying the percentage mass, which is already given. 69.9 and 30.1 over here, and dividing the percentage masses with the help of the atomic numbers of the elements. 69.9 is the mass percentage of iron. So I'm dividing 69.9 by atomic mass of iron. Similarly, 30.1 is the mass percentage of oxygen. So I'm dividing this by atomic mass of oxygen. This will be your first step. So here you go. With the first step, you're dividing 69.9 by atomic mass of iron and you're dividing 30.1 by atomic mass of oxygen, and the resultant values are here. This will be your first step. And now in the second step, what you got to do is you got to identify the least value out of this 1.25 and 1.88. So 1.25 is least. So what are you doing is you're dividing both the values independently by 1.25. So it will be 1.25 divided by 1.25. 1.88 divided by 1.25. So in the first case, it's going to be 1, and in the second case, it's going to be around 1.5. I slightly rounded it up, but then it's around 1.5. So now the ratio that I have is 1 and 1.5. So 1 is of iron, 1.5 is of oxygen. But then as said before, you can't have this kind of decimal. So you got to convert it into whole numbers by multiplying with a suitable number. I'm multiplying this whole with 2. 1 into 2 will be 2, 1.5 into 2 will be 3. So now the ratio of iron to oxygen is 2:3, which means 2 atoms of iron and 3 atoms of oxygen are making the empirical formula. Fe2O3 is the empirical formula. Fine. So you have calculated empirical formula already, but then the question is about molecular formula. I said that molecular formula is equal to empirical formula into N, and N is equal to molecular formula mass by empirical formula mass. So since you know the empirical formula mass, you know the empirical formula now, you can easily calculate the empirical formula mass, correct? But then molecular formula mass, how to identify it? You don't need to identify it. It's given in the question already. So now find out N. N is equal to molar mass, that is molecular formula's mass, 159.69 given in the question, divided by 159.7. From where did I get this 159.7? When I have taken the empirical formula mass, 2 irons, which is 2 into 55.85, plus 3 oxygens, 3 into 16, altogether was 159.69. So it is 159.69 by 159.69. Approximately it is same, 0.999, which approximated as 1. So which means N value is equal to 1. As said before, molecular formula is empirical formula into N. But right now, N is equal to 1. So I'll be multiplying Fe2O3 with 1 in order to acquire the molecular formula. And after doing so, I'll still be having Fe2O3 itself as molecular formula. This is how you have to calculate or you have to identify the molecular formula. I hope you could understand this, but in case you are stuck somewhere or you have something to ask about this, you can please let me know the same in the comments. Let's now go on to next question, number 1.9. This is considered as one of the important questions in your final examinations or school examinations. Calculate the atomic mass, in fact the average atomic mass of chlorine using the following data. When you look at the data, they are talking about two isotopes of chlorine. One is chlorine 35, other one is chlorine 37. So they have given the percentage of natural abundance. Naturally, chlorine 35 exists at 75.77% and chlorine 37 is 24.23%. And molar mass of those isotopes is also given individually. So now you have to calculate the average atomic mass of chlorine. First of all, how to calculate average atomic mass? There's a formula to calculate it. I'll write the formula over here. The average atomic mass of isotopes can be calculated as the fractional abundance of one isotope or isotope 1 into its molar mass plus the fractional abundance of the second isotope into its own molar mass. Like I'm writing it as M1 and M2. And in case you're having third isotope, it will be plus abundance of third isotope into its own molar mass. It goes on like that. So right now we are talking about two isotopes. So I'm stopping the formula over here. Abundance of first isotope, which is chlorine 35, is 75.77%. 77% is nothing but 75.77 by 100, right? Into its molar mass given is 34.96 here. I have substituted the values. And now, secondly, molar mass fractional abundance of chlorine 37 is 24.23%, which is like divided by 100 into its molar mass. When I simplify this, the answer that we acquire is 35.45, which can be rounded up to 35.5. atomic mass units. That's why in periodic table you will find the atomic mass of chlorine to be 35.5. This is an important question. Please do practice this. Let's go on to question number 1.10 now, 1.10 in fact. So the question says, in 3 moles of ethane, calculate the following. You're having a sample and the sample is 3 moles of ethane, 3 moles of C2H6. You have to calculate the number of moles of carbon atoms in this. You have to calculate the number of moles of hydrogen atoms in this, and you have to calculate the number of molecules of ethane in this sample. So how do we do this? First one, let's get started with number of moles of carbon atoms. Usually, when you look at methane, C2H6, in 1 mole of methane, you get to see 2 carbon atoms, right? So one molecule of methane has 2 carbon atoms. And now if I say, if 1 mole of methane is considered, 1 mole of methane is nothing but 6 into 10 power 23 molecules of methane. 1 molecule of methane is having 2 carbon atoms. 6 into 10 power 23 molecules, which is 1 mole of methane, will have how many carbon atoms? It has to be 2 into 6 into 10 power 23 atoms of carbon. But then what is this? This is the number of carbon atoms present in 1 mole of methane, right? But then in the question, they are talking about a sample of how much? 3 moles of methane, which means if 1 mole is consisting of 2 into 6, which is 12 into 10 power 23 carbon atoms, you are having 3 moles of methane. How many carbon atoms will this be having? Cross multiply. It will be 3 into 12 into 10 power 23, right? So it will be having 3 into 12 into 10 power 23. So this is the number of carbon atoms present, right? This is the total number of carbon atoms. But now in the question, they are asking us about what? Number of moles of carbon atoms. They are not asking you to calculate number of carbon atoms. Number of moles of carbon atoms is needed, right? So now I'm just simplifying this and writing it as 6 into 10 power 23, right? So now how is this 6 into 10 power 23 is nothing but Avogadro number, and 2 into 3 is nothing but 6. We can simplify and write it as 6n, which is 6 into Avogadro number. 6 into Avogadro number of particles are present. If one mole is consisting of Avogadro number, 6 into Avogadro number will be present in how many moles? 6 into n divided by n, where you cancel n and n, 6. So 6 moles of carbon atoms are present in 3 moles of methane. I hope this is clear. But just in case this is not clear, I'll give you a shortcut here. Okay. So the shortcut is, you're talking C2H6 and you got to calculate number of moles of carbon atoms. If you look at methane, one methane has 2 carbon atoms. And one mole of methane will have 2 moles of carbon atoms, right? And now you're talking about 3 moles of methane. How many moles of carbon atoms will be there in 3 moles of methane? Cross multiply. 3 into 2, which is equal to 6. 6 moles of carbon atoms. You can also cross multiply like this, okay? So the answer for the first part is 6 moles. And now the second one. The second part is how many moles of hydrogen atoms are present. Very same way we can calculate. So if you look at C2H6, 1 C2H6 has how many? 6 hydrogen atoms. If you are talking about 1 moles, it is having 6 moles of hydrogen atoms. And you are having a sample of 3 moles. 3 moles of C2H6 will have how many moles of hydrogen atoms? Cross multiply, it will be 3 into 6 moles divided by 1, which in turn is 18. 18 moles of hydrogen atoms will be present, right? And now the third question is, how many molecules of ethane is it? We already know that one mole of C2H6 will be consisting of Avogadro number of particles, which is nothing but 6.022. You can also write it as 6.023 into 10 power 23. So now, if one mole is consisting of so many number of atoms, how many molecules will be present in 3 moles? Cross multiply, it will be 3 into Avogadro's number, which is 6.022 into 10 power 23 divided by 1, which approximately will be 18, and the accurate calculation says 18.069 into 10 power 23, which is the answer for this question. So here we have calculated all the 3 parts: number of moles of carbon atoms, number of moles of hydrogen atoms, and number of molecules of ethane. So this is all about this video. We'll be continuing the next question, which is question number 1.11, in our next video. In case you are having any doubts, you want more such videos, you please let me know the same in the comment section. Until then, bye-bye everyone.